Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of the Alpha Pound Box Report. I am your host, Michael. Join me this week, Gail Falkenfeller, Communities Digital News. Sean Newton joined us live from Taiwan. What's going on, lady and gent?
Hello,
good
hello.
Evening. Good morning. It's the A-team in effect.
For those who are new to the Pound for Pound Box Report, the Pound for Pound Box Report is a live YouTube show slash blog slash podcast that discusses all things boxing. The motto is, when boxing is good, we will talk about it. When boxing is bad, we will talk about it. The bottom line is, if you're concerned the boxer, we will talk about it. If you want to find information about the Pound for Pound Box Report, one main place you should go to, that's the Pound for Pound Box Report blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com is the link. Let me repeat that, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com is the link where you can find articles and blog posts written not only by yours truly, but also by Gail Falkenbell herself, as well as Kayla M. Lewis on Twitter, KBC Live on G+. Also, if you check to the right of the blog page, you'll see links to where to find the Pound for Pound Box Report, all over social media, all over the internet webs. On Podomatic, where you can find all previous episodes of the podcast. You can find the links to where to find the Facebook page, the 2G Plus pages, the Tumblr page, the Twitter page, and the Twitter handle is at P4P Box Report, the YouTube page. We got a Pinterest board. We are on Stitcher Radio. Just go to StitcherRadio.com. Just do a search of boxing, and you will find the Pound for Pound Box Report, P-O-U-N-D, the number 4, P-O-U-N-D, Box Report. Please take time to check us out on Twitter, on Stitcher Radio, excuse me, and leave a review. Let us know what we're doing right with the show and how can we improve with the show. Also, on the blog page, you will see the email address, and that is p4pboxingrpt@gmail.com. And lastly, link to where you can donate your account, be a friend, be a pal, be a buddy. Donate your Twitter account. The link for that is donateyouraccount.com/p4pboxreport. And what happens is, any tweet that comes from the Pound for Pound Box Report Twitter page, your Twitter handle will automatically retweet any tweet that comes from the Pound for Pound Box Report Twitter page. And lastly, I forgot to mention this, go to RSS feed if you want to subscribe to the Pound for Pound Box Report. That way, you've got a link to the RSS feed. But that being said, let's get this show started tonight. Doing a recap of what went down last week, let's go to the big fight. We're a week now. We're finally getting over Mayweather-Pacquiao, and what a way to get over Mayweather-Pacquiao. It's Canelo Alvarez. James Kirkland went to war last Saturday night in Houston. Alvarez scoring a 3-round knockout over Kirkland in sensational fashion. As Dan Rayfield wrote in ESPN, for those who were disappointed in Mayweather-Pacquiao, especially given the cost of the pay-per-view, this fight was a bargain, and this fight should have helped you get over what many thought was a bore. I didn't think it was a bore, but what any others thought it was a bore. Kirkland did what he usually does. He comes out ready, coming out. He came out to fight, hit Canelo with some shots early. The commentators during the fight said he hurt him. I didn't think so personally. I didn't think Canelo Alvarez was as hurt as bad as the Jim Lampley and others felt. But the thing about Kirkland, I said this when previewing the show last week, for me, when you look at James Kirkland, he's too irresponsible defensively. He leaves himself open. He only fights one way, and I don't think he has the greatest chin in the world. And for me, I just think that Ann Wolf brings something extra mentally, spiritually with him. Ultimately, it wouldn't have mattered at the end of the day because Canelo Alvarez is a much better fighter, but I thought with Ann Wolf, he may have lasted longer. But Canelo, he was patient. He was cool. I must admit, I've been underestimating him a little bit. I love the way he picks his shots. I love the way he goes to the head and the body. He did that all night long on Kirkland. Put him down in round one, finished the job in round three, the uppercut during the first knockdown in round three, and follow-up right hand, sensational. I go to you on this one, Gail. Your assessment of the war between Canelo Alvarez and Kirkland, kind of a 2015 Hagler-Hearns for us.
A little bit of a mini Hagler-Hearns is certainly a short one. Canelo had a real coming out party in kind of an interesting way. You know, we've all watched him, like what we've seen. He's wildly popular, especially here in Southern California and Mexico, obviously. But this fight really took it to a new level. And I was incredibly impressed at the mix of punches that he used. Now, Kirkland made it really easy for him as far as presenting the target. And, you know, he can't do that with everybody. But take note that all three knockdowns, including the eventual knockout, were three different punches. That will serve him very, very well in all the years to come. And when I watched him during his media workout a few weeks ago, he was really working on a lot of different punches with Eddie Reynoso. And we saw it in the ring. Great performance. You know, we got more in that 8 minutes worth of in the ring with those two guys than we did get in 12 full rounds in Las Vegas a week or two ago. Not that it isn't exactly what those of us here on the Pound for Pound Report expected. We really did. But, you know, the fans who are casual fans left a little bit of a bad taste for them. So I hope a lot of them are watching to say, yeah, that's what I like about boxing. And hopefully they'll watch again this week to see Golovkin and Monroe. And Chocolatito and Sosa, for that matter, for a great show.
Your thoughts on the fight, Sean?
Yeah, first of all, it was great.
First of all, excuse me, Sean. I want to say joining us live right now is Jay Dale. What's going on, Jay Dale?
What's going on, guys? A lot of boxing to talk about.
Yeah, absolutely. Proceed, Sean. I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, I mean, you know, this fight played out pretty much like most of us last week thought. A few people sort of saw it differently. But, I mean, most of us felt that Canelo was the better fighter. He had more skills. And that Kirkland defensive was open to get countered and had a bad chin. So it sort of played out the way we expected. But, I mean, all props to Canelo. He did what he needed to do. And it, you know, it boosted his stock a lot. I mean, after having some fights with top-quality fighters but who have negative styles, it's nice to get him in the ring with some guys that sort of expose him to the general public and show him as an exciting fighter. Because, I mean, nothing against him fighting guys like Laura and Trout and Floyd, but they are hard styles, difficult styles, and they're not going to make him look good, even if he got victories off of them. I mean, because it's not like you would expect him to go out and blow those guys out, because definitely they're not going to allow that kind of thing. So it becomes much more technical. And that's fine. I mean, we want to see great fighters fight great fighters, and we know that some fights are going to be more technical than others. That's why styles make fights, and, you know, that mantra has always been stated, and it means a lot. And, you know, to get Canelo into a fight like this after last week's fight, which, you know, I mean, played out like people figured it would, but now you get this excitement back in boxing, and now GGG and Chocolito are coming this week. You know, it's two great weekends of boxing following, you know, a big hype job. And, you know, it's good for boxing to have these fights follow up because, I mean, it shows the diversity and how fights are different and how things play different and, you know, some of the other great names in boxing. So it was a great fight for Canelo, and I was happy to see him go out there and destroy Kirkland quickly.
I'll go to you on this one, Jay Dale. First of all, your assessment of the fight, and follow up with a couple of quick questions to follow up. It was a lot of mention of Ann Wolfe in her absence heading into the fight. She was interview popped up, I believe, on Ellie Setback's channel the following day, Sunday, talking about how the fight would have been different if she would have been in his corner. So talk about the fight itself. Talk about Ann Wolfe not being there. Do you think it made much of a difference, or do you think that Canelo, he would have had his way with Kirkland even with Ann Wolfe in his corner?
Well, like I said last week, if Canelo controls it with the jab and go to the body, it was going to slow Kirkland down. But if it goes beyond three, you know, Kirkland could sustain the onslaught, he would have had a better chance. But anyways, to answer your question, it wouldn't matter if Ann Wolfe was or was not in that ring, because James Kirkland's style, his aggression, helps a guy like Canelo, who likes to counter counter you when you overreach your shots and everything. And Kirkland was making Canelo's job a lot easier by Canelo stepping back. All he had to do was step back, let Kirkland throw some shots. Then he could counter him with a left hook, hold his power hand, let the ref reset it, throw a right hand, stun Kirkland, go to the body, get some head shots, stun Kirkland again, and then when Kirkland gets aggressive, make him overreach and throw an uppercut, which will make him go down, a shot he didn't see coming, and then eventually do a Mike Tyson shot to a heavyweight, which is go low to throw the high top right hand. And that was vicious. But, I almost kind of cried seeing that fight because it was just devastating to see a man take so much punishment. I mean, for both guys.
Yes.
It's like, at one point, I felt kind of guilty liking the action, but I felt kind of sick watching
it. The way Kirkland went down in that second knockdown, the way his body was completely limp, that was kind of scary.
Yeah, you know, I was like, man, is this guy going to die in this fight tonight? Like, he just kept going. I mean, this was like some Gotti Ward type stuff early. This was beyond Hagler Hearns to me. But the way James just took them body shots and them head shots and a mixed combo and just kept going. But his shots didn't have no pop to them. Even though Canelo got a little stunned early, Canelo was able to be calm, cool, collective, reset, turn James around, throw the jab, throw body shots, and all that stuff. But overall, Canelo controlled this fight, even though James had some action here and there. But it wouldn't have mattered if Ann Wolf was in there or not. James is just too aggressive, and he's a counterpuncher's dream, which is Canelo's type of style to fight. Now, to further this, Sean Newton said it was negative style Canelo was fighting. I mean, I thought the Trout versus Canelo fight was pretty exciting. I thought Lara versus Angulo, since Angulo knows how to cut off the ring, that was a hell of a fight. It's just, I know, you forgot about that fight, didn't you?
No, I don't forget. I just think, I mean, Laura fought differently because he was fighting a guy that wasn't the same quality.
But, you know, like Canelo did to Kirkland, you know, go high. I mean, low to throw high. That's what Angulo kept on doing with the left hook to Laura to knock him down twice. I mean, that was a good fight in how Laura came back and throw them left hands. But anyways, to the point, Kirkland, as much as we want to say he's a warrior and all this, I wish he had some head movement. I wish he had some lateral movement. He would have made this fight a lot longer than how early it just ended. And I'm just that the fight was over with quick, because the more of a beating I saw, the more I would just hope somebody throw the towel in the ring or something, because that was just devastating. But also, high action. And you know, casual fans from Facebook who usually don't watch boxing actually saw the replay of that fight and enjoyed it. They said, that's what boxing's about. That's what boxing should be about. And I said, you idiots. Boxing better not be like this, because I like diversity. I like pugilists. I like boxing punchers. Guys who can fight but can box. You know, like guys like Sugar Ray Leonard and them type of fighters. Like, I want to see more skillsmen like that. But, you know, overall, I enjoyed the fight, but then at the same time, I felt kind of bad. Because, you know, I thought James was dead after that, man.
Let me piggyback off what you just said and ask a question to everybody on the panel. First of all, let me say, you're right. I tend to agree with you, J.D., in terms of your last statement. As much as we love fights like that, let's face it, fights like that, they take toll not only your career, but ultimately your life. You keep fighting fights like that over and over and over and over, it will shorten your life. It will shorten your career. And fighters, and noticeable fighters who continually go in those kind of wars, how they sound when they're 50, 55 years old, not only how they sound, but how their bodies are. So to your point, boxing is a mixture of the two. It is ultimately is the art of hitting and not being hit. Boxing at its best has that kind of style. Guys who love, who are boxing pugilists, who are on the one hand, but also you will have your fights where they are just wars. But to your earlier point, do you? And again, this question is for everybody on the panel. Do you think this is the kind of performance that even raises the bar, raises the level of Canelo even more? He was already a star going in. But given this kind of fight, given his performance following Mayweather-Pacquiao, and for those who didn't watch it on HBO, this fight followed the replay of Mayweather-Pacquiao. Piggybacking off of that, do you think this raises Canelo's profile even more, or could it be a case of people maybe giving this Canelo more credit than he deserves because of the limitations of Kirkland? Your thoughts, and anybody can respond. Sean, go ahead.
Gail? You know, a lot of anybody's, you know, fame or stardom achievements has to be taken in context and under the circumstances in which they occur. And we have a couple of forces all brewing to make Canelo a big star. Number one, Mexico is hungry for someone to carry the banner. And they thought it was going to be Chavez Jr. Well, boy, we know it isn't. He is not the heir apparent to his father. He's not. My dogs agree. And so they're looking, you know, they're really, really hungry. Who is the next great Mexican hope? You know, in Canelo's case, you have to almost say the great white hope. And he put on exactly the show they were hungry for, especially after that horrible embarrassment with Chavez Jr. And comes on the heels of being in general as just good boxing fans disappointed with Mayweather Pacquiao, particularly because Mexican fans are fans of Manny and not Floyd. And I'm gonna shut my mic off and take care of
my dog. Gail's dog is starting to act up a little bit. Join us live is EJ Boxing Live and What You Need. What's going on, fellas?
How you doing, man? How you doing, guys?
Good. Let me quickly go to both of you and get your assessments of the fight before I proceed on into What You Need and Sean in terms of the question on hand. Your thoughts on the fight? Canelo Alvarez's win over Kirkland and the way he blasted him out in three rounds. EJ Boxing Live, What You Need?
I'll go eat crow in that one, boy.
You know what? I wasn't going to mention that. Kirkland to win.
Yeah, I came over to you, my friend. Listen, I'd probably bury him again. It's just circumstances. The bare man won. I don't got no excuse. I put money down as well. So if you won, I would have got a nice payday, trust me, because I put money on the Madonna fight. He won. I put money on Burns. He lost, but I thought he won. And I put money down on Kirkland. So, like, you know, one out of three is not that bad. But end of the day, the bare man won. Canelo showed what he's about. And I'll tell you what, man. It shows you how good Floyd is to evade some of them shots, because them shots he looked like, there's a picture on Facebook with Kirkland's soul leaving his body when that punch landed on him. It was devastating. That punch was devastating, and Canelo shown that he's the top guy in that division, whatever division he's in, because it's the catchweight. But he's definitely a good fighter, and Kirkland, we see what he does now. But to be honest with you, he's been out the ring for so long, and Wolf and the whole situation, it's like it wasn't meant to be, and that's the way it is. But Kirkland, Canelo goes on, and let's try and get the cutoff fight and see what happens there. But yeah, like I said, the Kame Macro, I picked the wrong guy, so that's how it goes sometimes.
Join us as well, live from the UK, Mr. Boxing Addict. What's going on?
Hey guys, how you doing?
How you doing?
I'll go to What You Need, and then I'll go back. Then I'll go to you on this one, Boxing Addict. Your thoughts on Canelo Alvarez, his win, his stoppage over James Kirkland. First, What You Need, then you, Mr. Boxing Addict.
Afternoon, everybody. Yeah, well, I didn't it's not supposed to be where the brawler beats the boxer, especially an elite boxer like Canelo Alvarez. And I think the week before I called it, and a lot of people were saying Kirkland's going to do this to Canelo and that, and I was like, okay, if you say so, you know. Kirkland came out hard. I think he caught with Canelo with a shot, I can't remember which, and all Canelo did was shell up. So he did what he was supposed to do, took his time, broke down Kirkland, and got him out of there. And I'm it's impressive in the sense that how he is sensational in how he put away Kirkland. You know, it was very sensational, sensational performance. But I expected such a thing to happen. You know, I saw him fight Angulo. Same story. So I was impressed. You know, I was yelling and screaming and shouting. I was saying, this brawler, he can't, you know, he's not supposed to beat this boxer. So, you know, Canelo took his time, put him away. And I'm happy about that. It's supposed to go that way. It was a mismatch. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
It was a mismatch fight as far as I'm concerned. And if Canelo can still make 154 pounds, the person I really want to see him fight is either Vanes Matarossian or Demetrius Andrade. I think he beats both of them, but I would still love to see those fights at 154. If not, and he's moving up to 160, I guess it's going to be Miguel Cotto first. He may get a shot at Cotto before GGG. So if he gets a shot at Cotto, I see him winning again against Cotto. He's too smart. He's too intelligent.
Mr. Boxing Ad, I gotta go to you. Your assessment of Canelo Alvarez's win over James Kirkland and the way he destroyed Kirkland in the third round. To J. Dale's point, it was sensational, but it was kind of scary the way Kirkland went down and went out.
Yeah, it sure was. Canelo proved he's a class above, though. Everybody thought that going into it. I think we touched on it last week. You know, where I said he's a poor man's Nigel Benn, isn't he, Kirkland? You know, he didn't have the skill to really do much against Canelo, and that proved on the night. And Canelo proved he's a top 154 out there. I'd like to see him in there maybe with Golovkin at a catchweight now, something like that. Maybe 157, 158. But yeah, it was a bit of a mismatch for me from the beginning, so yeah.
I'll return back to the question before EJ and what you need and Mr. Boxing Addict joined in. The question I was asking, fellas, and I'll go to you on this one, Jay Dales, and you can follow up, Sean. A lot of buzz about Canelo following the fight, a lot of talk about him. Given context is always critical, as Dale mentioned earlier, this fight happened immediately following the replay of Mayweather-Pacquiao. Given this is basically off the back of Mayweather-Pacquiao, given how Canelo performed, how the fight went, do you think that this rises the level of stardom for Canelo even more, who was a star coming in? Or could it be a case of, given Kirkland's limitations, particularly defensively, given how he's a one-dimensional fighter, do you think that maybe Canelo is getting a little bit more credit than he deserves following the win over Kirkland? I'll go to you on this one. Jay Dales are dead. Sean, and then everybody else can join in.
Okay. There's two ways to answer this. Number one, for a casual fan, yes, he became a star that night. For a hardcore boxing fan, you saw this happening, or you saw it the other way happening, because let's face it, one of Canelo's deficiencies that I always saw, other than what Mayweather shown, is his stamina. You know, he has stamina issues, but in this fight, you know, I must say that he showed me that he could take on a strong man, aggressive style. And in a way, it kind of justified why he wanted to take on James Kirkland a year and a half ago. Now I see why. But I got to give him his credit. But does this make me looking at him as a superstar in the making off of this fight? No. I wish I saw this type of performance against somebody like Aris Landy Lara. You know, like, let me see how you do against guys who got good lateral movement, guys who are not willing to engage with you. You got to engage with them, and you got to fight flat-footed. And but to answer the question, like, I want to see him fight someone who's a boxer puncher, like a Matt Rosen, and see if he could do the same performance. If he could do that to Matt Rosen, or if he could do that to Andrade, or hell, if he can even do that to someone like Miguel. Now, I'll tell you what will make Canelo Alvarez a superstar. If he does that annihilation to Miguel Cotto. If he does that to Cotto, he's boxing's new kingpin, plain and simple. Because he, not only did he demolish a big name in boxing, he did it in impressive fashion, and he's doing it against a lineal champion at middleweight. And then after that fight, people going to want to see him and Triple G go at it. So I pass the mic to whoever wants it.
Sean?
Hi. You know, it's funny how people love to sort of twist things for their own advantage. In a case like this, I mean, people wanted Canelo to fight the skilled fighters. He fought them. I mean, he fought the best fighter in the world, and he lost because he just wasn't ready for a guy at that caliber. And even after that, he still went on to fight another really slick fighter in Lara. And he squeaked out a close victory against an awkward guy who's tough to fight. And people want to say, sort of take shine away after he has a spectacular win against a guy like Kirkland, who is limited. But that's why we say styles make fights. Some styles make exciting fights. Some styles don't. When you fight guys like Laura and Floyd, there is no exciting fight generally, unless they're blowing your ass out. And then it's them having an exciting fight because they're fighting a guy who they really are superior to, and they can really open up their offense, which they usually don't do. I mean, it's like Sugar Ray Leonard. Who would say he's not an exciting fighter and that he wasn't a superstar? Nobody. But he fought Floyd's father, and it was a very slow, technical, awkward, not an exciting fight. But because he had that fight against that style, people don't rip him and say that he's not legitimate, because then he did go and fight legitimate fighters and have great fights. So yes, he is going to fight Cotto, and he's going to stop Cotto. And then people are going to say, well, Cotto's old. He's already lost to Manny, Floyd, Margarito, beat the crap out of him with cheating gloves, and they're going to make excuses of why it's not legitimate. And people are going to take shine away from them. Huh?
But folks can't say that. Folks can't say that, the way, given the fact that Cotto performed much better against Mayweather than a Pacquiao did.
He won just about the same amount of rounds. So, in truth, he didn't really do better. It's just people expected less from
him. I gave Cotto more rounds against Mayweather than I gave Pacquiao, and Cotto, he brought the fight more to Pac. He did what Pacquiao should have done in terms of bringing the fight to him.
Yeah, because his style is more that way.
He was able to get to Pacquiao with shots that I knew Pacquiao wouldn't. So, if folks want to make that argument, they're talking about.
But people are going to make that argument. You know, I'm only telling you what's going to happen. Yeah, not speculation. It's fact. People are going to say that. So, you know, I think we should just give him props because, of course, he did a great job against this style. You could say, oh, what's he going to do against Laura in a rematch or Andrade, who is much taller with a longer reach, who also is Andrade, a little more offensive, but I mean, still unproven. I mean, you know, he hasn't really fought anybody and stepped up yet. But obviously, he's going to be a tough style. He would be a tough style for Floyd. And obviously, he's going to be a tough style for Canelo. He has a much longer reach. He's far taller. I mean, you know, that's a tough fight. Marta Rosian, it'll be an exciting fight. Their styles make it that way. I mean, styles make fights. Canelo is a superstar. I mean, you know, that's just a fact. And when he beats Cotto, he's going to become even bigger, especially with Manny and Floyd, you know, going out the front door. So, you know, I think we should just expect good fights and hope that he keeps doing what he's doing, which is fight top-level competition of different styles.
DJ Boxing Live, what you got to say about this, brother?
Hey, man, Canelo, hey, Canelo's the dude, man. He's that dude, boy. Mexico versus Puerto Rico, that is, that, you know, that wherever that is, maybe it's Madison Square Garden, maybe it's going to be in Texas, wherever it is, that's going to be a bomb burner. And, you know, people, from the back of that, you're saying, and I agree that, like, you know, Canelo seems like he's the favorite. He's very strong, very powerful. But, yes, the land, you know, Cotto's not easy, you know, especially early in his career. He was a very good defensive fighter. Later in his career, you know, it seems like he can hit, move his head a bit. He's fought the better opponents, but Canelo's fought the top guys at a higher weight class and done pretty well. But Cotto's the lineage champion. It's a toss-up, but people probably think Cotto's probably going to win. Like I said, Puerto Rico versus Mexico is going to be a big fight. Whoever wins, maybe they have a rematch, depending on what happens. But we'll see what happens. And I'm not going to just say, like, whoever wins is going to fight Triple G. I don't think none of them want to fight, really, Triple G. Let's probably wait for Triple G to retire or something, because Triple G is the bogeyman. Like, there's nothing to gain for them guys fighting him other than throwing your career away. They're not going to fight him. It's like, Triple G is just going to be collecting skulls over there in the middleweight division. He don't need to do anything. He can just stay there and just wrap up all the belts in that division and be one of them guys in boxing that no one even wanted to challenge. But I don't see Canelo going up there. Canelo just stay where he is. Tapia, Cotto. Like I said, what happens in that fight? Maybe they have a rematch, you know? It's a mega fight, big money fight, so we'll see where that goes. But Canelo right now is looking like the dude. Let's see what Cotto does in his fight against Gil. If Cotto blows him out, it's going to make it even blows out Gil. That'll make it bigger. But it's not a given that he's going to beat Gil comfortably. We'll see. Gil's got a good engine. He's got good stamina. He will be a test. I know he's not fighting at 160 for the first time, but I think it should be a good fight. We'll see how Gil fares. Maybe he might be weight drained and come in too weak, but we'll see. But when them two fight, it'll be a great fight. Hopefully, maybe they fight again, but I don't see no one, in my opinion, them guys fighting up, fighting Triple G. No one. Even Floyd. It's like, why? Why am I fighting him for? It's like, what's the point? You know, everyone went Floyd to fight Manny, he done that, so I don't see why anyone wants to fight Triple G, in my opinion, unless you have to. You don't need to be fighting that type of dude. He hits too hard, and he's just bringing bare pressure, and he's still establishing himself. So Triple G, for me, is out the window. Let's see what Cotto and Canelo do, so that's what I have to say on that.
I'll go finally to you on Mr. Boxing Addict, as well as you, what you need. Following the win, Canelo's win over Kirkland, does this elevate him to even a higher level of stardom, or are they giving too much credit here because of the limitations of a James Kirkland? And also talk about the future of Canelo Alvarez.
Yeah, I don't think Canelo's getting the credit he deserves, actually. He's been there with Mayweather, he's been in there with Laura, like Sean was saying, he's met all those different styles. So he's doing it at top level. He's beating everybody. Okay, he couldn't get past Mayweather, but, you know, who does? So, who's out there now? Cotto, and that's probably about it. Unless he was to have a rematch, I suppose, with Laura somewhere along the lines, but nobody really wants to see that. So, let's see him in there with Cotto. If that can happen, that will be huge, won't it? That's a massive fight. Who would win? I'd have to favour Canelo. Younger, seems stronger, and he's a boxer, like we touched on last week. He's a boxer. He's not just a banger, but he can do both. And I think he would probably stop Cotto late, personally. And then from there, why not? Let's have a catch weight, or even, because Canelo, I believe, can go up to 160. From what I've heard in the past, he struggles a little bit at the weight, and he certainly looks big, and he's young enough to probably move up. So let's see him in there with Golovkin. Maybe he's the only person out there who can give Golovkin a test, unless he moves up to 168, of course.
What you need?
Well, I don't think this performance was about the hardcore fans trying to approve it. It was to get more fans, basically. It's a showcase fight. So the Kirkland fight was basically to showcase Canelo. Yeah. And the second point I have to make is that the way how Canelo took out Kirkland, you guys have to understand, this guy thought about what he was doing, was very methodical. This was very systematic how he broke down Kirkland. You have to understand that. Not anyone can do what Canelo just did. Okay? People think, oh, Kirkland, he had no defense, three rounds. The guy had a lot of heart. You saw him get up from a knockdown. Okay? This guy has a good chin. Kirkland, believe it or not, has a good chin. When his engine gets running, you know, he goes. He's like Angulo. But Canelo, he basically weathered the storm that Kirkland came at him with veteran moves. There's a lot of those things. How he rolled the punches, how he went into that ball, how he started to roll the punches with his guard. He rolled the punches Kirkland was doing. Close the distance, establish that jab on Kirkland, and then land a straight right to establish distance. So Kirkland started to lunge in. He started to lunge in, and when he lunged in, uppercut, right? Feint to the body, right hook. Feint to the body, okay? Now people think Canelo's just a banger, he's an offensive guy, and no, he's not. He's a boxer. He reminds me of a very slow, a slow version of the younger Floyd Mayweather. I keep on saying this over and over. These two guys are very, very similar. That's why
Canelo actually... Explain that.
Okay. The younger Floyd, when he was fighting lesser opposition, he chopped them down, right? He destroyed them, okay? The younger Floyd was very calculated as well. He places his punches specific places, to the liver, to slow you down, the jab to the pit, okay? You notice Canelo was also using the jab to the pit. He's slower than Floyd. So the same moves, the same mindset, it's the same thing operating in there. He jabbed Kirkland to the pit. Did you notice that? He waited for Kirkland to expend a lot of energy, throw a lot of combos, and then jab to the pit, suck the life out of you, right? Did you notice that in the fight?
Yeah.
Okay? He's systematic. He's like Floyd. He's very systematic in how he wears down his opponents. He focused on those body shots, and he really put leverage into it. Yes, he has a great left hook, but people don't talk about his overhand right. Nobody talks about his straight right. Nobody talked about his right hook, okay? The left hook obviously hurt Kirkland, and that was after Kirkland came hard at him, and it's the timing. He waits for you to expend your energy, and like a veteran, he's waiting on you. He's rolling on the ropes, you know. And then when you are about to suck in air, that's when he lands his shots on you. You get what I'm saying? That's the kind of guy Canelo Alvarez is. He's thinking all the time. He knew he had to calm down. He said in the first round he was going too fast, so he slowed himself down. He didn't do like, what's that dude? Glenn Tapia. He knocked down Kirkland, or he got Kirkland in trouble, and no. Pace yourself, take your time, let the guy do what he's doing. You're watching, you're observing him. Style's a little awkward, okay? All right? To get your body positioned, to get that leverage in. Feint him, create a little distance, feint him to the body, feint him to the head, pop him. Feint as if you're going to jab straight right. You know, you could see that Canelo was thinking in there. And a guy like that, yeah, it's hard to beat, okay? He's hard to beat. Now, a lot of people underestimate Canelo Alvarez, right? When he fought Arislandi Lara, that dude, Arislandi Lara kept on throwing that straight right followed by the straight left, right? Canelo Alvarez slipped the straight right to get inside and land his straight right. You remember when he landed that uppercut on Arislandi Lara as well? You guys got to understand, this guy is levels. They're saying he should have when he got Arislandi Lara on the ropes, he should have just come in. He's not going to just come in. He's a boxer. He's going to set it up, right? And this is the thing that people, they don't understand. They think he's a Mexican cojones, you know, great, great heart. No, he's not that dude. He's a thinker, okay? So, he's so short and stubby, you wouldn't think that this guy could get in. When he landed that straight right on Austin Trout, people don't understand what happened. He feinted. He threw the jab. He stepped jab into Austin Trout. Then he went back and he feinted the jab, which provoked a jab from Austin Trout, slipped the jab, and landed that straight right inside. Canelo Alvarez is way ahead of the game. This kid is out there, right? But he's not the fastest guy in the world. He has good hand speed. He's not the quickest foot speed guy, but he's really smart. And that's the difference between Canelo Alvarez and the rest of the guys you see, right? So all I'm saying is this kid is special. I knew When I first saw him fight against Cotto's younger brother or older brother, which one it was, when he rocked him, and I saw how he got his composure, collected himself, and came back on this dude to stop him. You have to acknowledge this kid is very, very smart. Very, very smart. And that's the difference between him and other guys. I was disappointed when he said Aris Landy Lara ran, because he knows better than that. He's a boxer. I didn't expect him to make that kind of excuse. And I don't have a problem seeing him rematch Aris Landy Lara. I don't have a problem with seeing him go against anybody at 154, because I know this kid, he has a brain. He's going to adjust. He's going to adapt with his skill, and he's going to do whatever needs to be done to get a W. I know that already. Same kind of guy like Floyd. People say Floyd's fights are boring. As Canelo gets to the higher and higher levels, you're going to probably say the same thing about him, because he thinks in there. He's not going to just, you know, he's not just going to bang. He's not going to do it, right? So that's what I think about him. His future is bright. I think he shouldn't face GGG yet, even though he could, because Shane Mosley outboxed GGG in a sparring session. So I know GGG's a very good boxer, don't get me wrong. But I think Canelo has what it takes to beat GGG. And you guys may not believe this, but this kid, he's special, I'm telling you. And whenever he faces GGG, he'll handle him real easy.
Yeah, but you know what? Yeah, I'm
just
still
saying it now. I said it.
See the comparison with Floyd. It's not there's I don't see nothing of that. The comparison to Chavez, Julio Cesar Chavez Senior.
No, I disagree with that. In my opinion, in the way of his punch selection,
yeah, on his way punch selection, that's what I'm talking about. That's the only difference. That's the only to me. And another thing as well, what you said, yeah, like Triple G, him, if he sees Triple G walking on the same side of the street, he needs to cross the road. Triple G, he's not even like, you don't want to face someone like that. Like, he don't want to, the Oscar De La Hoya knows, yeah, that's not where Canelo needs to go. Triple G's an older dude, he's looking for a big fight, maybe he might move up, or maybe he'll just clean out the division, but you don't want to fight someone like Triple G in any tier. 5 years time, you just leave him alone. It's a nightmare. Cotto, yeah, not Triple G, there's no, not even in the future, it doesn't make no sense, but that's just my opinion, isn't it?
Well, here's my point on that. Triple G has a range at which he fights. He fights mid-range to inside. Triple G's a guy who shifts a lot. Okay, he can box very well. You know, better than normal, basically. But he shifts. He uses a lot of hooks to leverage his body, right? This is Triple G. This is basically the style you're facing. Canelo Alvarez, he's short and pudgy, true. But the thing about Canelo Alvarez you got to understand is this kid has veteran moves. Canelo, believe it or not, as slow as he looks, is not going to be easy to hit.
It's not about
now,
that.
People will disagree with me. Some people will disagree with me. They'll say, oh, he doesn't ever take a shot flush.
No, it's not about that. It's the power.
Try to fight again.
Canelo, yeah, when he fought Floyd, yeah, he had trouble with Floyd's power after what he wear down. Now, someone like Triple G, could probably hit up and his power could probably go up to the cruiserweight limit. Like, Canelo's not the biggest puncher in his division. He's not. But Triple G clearly is, and his power clearly looked like he's in his division and two divisions higher. Like, it's suicide, man. It's suicide.
What I'm saying to you is a lot of people get caught up in the power of even if you've got good defense,
yeah, the power is going to start landing on you, bro. That's the not so thing you want to get in there. And if he's like, that's my opinion. Like, he hits way too hard. Even if you're gonna miss some punch, eventually some of them will get through, and it's not gonna be nice, bro. Trust me, man. Especially with that skull punch. You know that one with that bolo punch where he lands on the top of your skull like he done to the Mexican guy in the stop off. Nah, man. That's just my opinion anyway. Mm-hmm. So anyway,
remember that punch against Marco Antonio Rubio wasn't the punch that hurt him. It was the uppercut that caught him.
I'm just saying. Punches like that. Talking about his selection, the punches.
But
like
it's just his timing. He catches you on an off timing when you're not bracing for the shot. You brace too early.
If you got Canelo beating Triple G, all right, then fine. I just disagree. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, let's move on. Let's move on and talk about other boxing matters that's happening. Earlier Saturday, PBC on CBS card, it happening in Houston. Headlined by Omar Figueroa fighting Ricky Burns. Let's just put it out there. This fight was you knew that Figueroa was the favorite coming in. You knew that if it was going to a decision, it was going to go Omar Figueroa's way. Laurence Cole made sure of that, given his incompetence in the way he acted during the fight. Boxing fans, you want to know how a referee can bar a fight and how he can interject and how he can do just too damn much? You saw it. You saw it Saturday afternoon in Houston, Texas. Figueroa, he got the decision over Burns, 117-109 on one scorecard, 116-110 on the two other scorecards. Personally, I thought the fight was much closer than that. An argument can be made if it wasn't for the points being taken away from Burns by that dumbass Laurence Cole. You take away that, there could be an argument that Burns won the fight. I thought he was very effective landing counter punches. Figueroa, all he did was maul and grab throughout, particularly as the fight went along, he couldn't land with the shots on Burns that they thought he could. He couldn't land it with shots that he thought he could land on Burns with. I'll go to you on this one, Gail, and you can follow up, EJ. I know you were talking about this fight on Twitter. I was talking about it on Twitter as well, Gail. I was throwing the hashtag suspend Laurence Cole, ban Laurence Cole throughout the fight. talk about the fight itself and talk about the Laurence Cole himself and how he keeps getting these opportunities, how he keeps landing these fights in Texas even though he doesn't deserve it. And for those who don't know Cole, he's been in trouble before. He's had questionable he's done questionable things before. He was suspended back in 2006, suspended for I believe like a year. How he's connected, again, the fight itself and just the incompetence of Laurence Cole, who may be the worst referee in the sport, and how his actions kind of just took away what Burns could do.
Yeah. You know, have you ever worked somewhere where a relative of the boss is an employee and you got to work with that person? And frequently they're incompetent or lazy or just a pain in your backside for one reason or another. I don't know anybody who hasn't had that happen. That's Laurence Cole, okay? Daddy is a big cheese with the Texas Boxing Commission. And it doesn't matter what Laurence Cole does or how much he screws up or, in the case here, whether he comes damn close to getting in the way and endangering bullfighters and himself by grabbing at them, he's not going to lose his job. He'll get suspended. He'll get pushed off to less visible fights maybe here and there. But he just keeps turning up, just like that, son of the boss, lazy, no good, person you got to put up with, and you eventually learn either to just go around them or, do what you can to fend them off or cover because they're not going away, and that's the problem with Laurence Cole. But it is very instructive for the general fan getting to see this, and this was one of those PBC afternoon broadcasts in the United States on a major broadcast network, CBS. They get to see when a referee is interfering like that, how it can affect the fight. Really a credit to Burns and Figueroa that neither of them lost their temper over it, which could have easily happened. That's the last thing a fighter wants to have to deal with when they're in a tough fight like that. These guys were, is to deal with, a third problem in the ring there. They both handled themselves pretty well, considering. And I do think Burns won the fight. Figueroa's last fight was a very different affair. Last August, he looked great. He stepped on the gas when he needed to. He pulled out a great knockout win. He's a completely different guy this time. And I can only imagine that was due to Burns and his skill. And it was a little bit of a shame, and I think a bit of hometown judging. It was a close fight. It wasn't a horrible robbery, but,
A bit, Gail?
A bit. I'm being kind. You see a hometown judgment like that, and you kind of have to just, you almost come to expect it. In fact, it's been a pleasure lately that we haven't had too many. I think back to the same card Figueroa was on when I last saw him, and that was the undercard of Porter Brook, where every single one of us sitting there in the ringside said, well, Brook won, but Porter's going to get the judges, glory hallelujah, they actually gave Brooke the victory away from home. That was a very nice thing to see. But, you know, here we have one of those situations where, you know, in baseball, tie goes to the runner, supposedly. You know, in boxing, anything within a stone's throw, you know, goes to the hometown guy. Now,
absolutely.
Talk about this, EJ. This fight really, really, yeah, really annoyed me. Annoyed me to no end. Fact that he let Figueroa get away with stuff. The fact that anytime Burns tried to do anything, Cole would kind of hit at his arm while in close. Not just hit at his arm, grab his arm and pull it away. Mm-hmm. While letting Figueroa just maul and be borderline dirty. And I know Figueroa's your boy. I know you like him a lot, EJ, but he's no. In terms of how he would compete against junior welterweights in the world, no way.
Well,
he's average at best.
You've already made up your mind about Omar. Omar's always gonna be like the underdog anyway.
There's a reason I call him Tone Low, bro.
Go ahead, tell everyone. Go ahead and tell everyone why you call him Tone Low. Go ahead.
Me and Chris Caban, we call him Tone Lope, Funky Cole Medina, because of the way he fights. No offense, but when he won the lightweight belt, I felt he was overrated. I still feel that when he moved up, partly because he struggled to make weight, but another part is he didn't want Jorge Linares. Jorge Linares would spank him. I was on Twitter with Giangelo Buffo, bad coach Jeanette. We were talking about Figueroa. We both agreed that, you know, Lamont Peterson would spike him. Danny Garcia would spike him. Mm-hmm. He can't compete with the top level at 140 pounds, and it showed in this fight. And to Gail's point, just the referee, man, it just go on. I'm going to let you burn. I'm talking too much.
That's my guy. Like I said, Figueroa is my guy. I like Omar because they're always down on Figueroa, but this one here, I ain't gonna lie, I thought he lost the fight to Burns, man. And that referee, that was disgraceful. That was disgraceful. I've seen a referee do that before, that when the fighter is fighting, what he's trying to do, right? He's trying to make the action continue. So his way of pulling the arm away is trying to stop the fight from holding. Instead of him saying break, he's trying to grab the arm away and so the fighter can move his arm in a position where he can just be throwing punches. But what he was doing, he was holding onto the wrist and holding it up, pulling it up, because Burns was fighting against it, obviously. And then, obviously, Figueroa, with his head in there, was throwing these hooks. And it was disgraceful. It was disgraceful that, especially the commentary over in the UK, I mean, we picked up on it, but someone, like, I was thinking the trainer should have said something. Someone should have said something to the referee. Call the referee, what are you doing? Like, how can you even get away with this? There was no world title on the line yet, but how can someone get away with this? And no one said, this is on normal TV. It was horrible. Like, I've seen it before. Like I said, I've seen it before. I think his referee, it was a female fight between, what's her name again? It was Oxlar Castillo versus Cecilia Brakus. And the referee was Mickey Van. And he was doing the same thing. I've seen it before. And I couldn't believe it then. It's dangerous. Like, when you grab a fighter's arm, it leaves people open, especially the fighter's fatigue. Now he's open to get shots, and it's like Burns is in there fighting two people, and the scorecard. I mean, what was that on the scorecards? Like, when Burns was established his jab, he was doing pretty well. In the last round, I gave Figueroa won that last round, but the majority of rounds, when Burns had him in the middle of the ring, Burns was just leading. Like, he was, for me, he was dictating the pace with his jab and doing pretty well. But because of the inside thing, like, Burns is usually, in the UK especially, yeah, when they get in that situation where they're that tight, the referee will break them apart. And at that point, Burns was looking for that so he could establish his jab, but the referee wouldn't do that. The referee wanted him to stay inside, and it suited Figueroa, who was just in there with his head and just throwing punches. And Figueroa looked like a complete novice compared to what Gelda said in his last fight. His last fight, he looked really good. And you're right, Michael, he did duck Linares. Of course, they want no part of Linares. He gave up his belt not to avoid him. And that's why what's his name? Thingy's fighting him over in the UK. So, you know, that you can see Omar Figueroa and his people, they're trying to keep him away from certain people. But Omar Figueroa continues doing what he's doing. I don't think he won that fight. I gave that, for me, I thought Burns won that fight. But like I said, Burns was fighting two Pelina. Oh, yeah, he's fighting Kevin Mitchell, by the way, in the UK.
Yes.
Yeah, he's fighting Kevin Mitchell. So Linares were talking about. But what I'm saying is that for me, Omar Figueroa lost that fight for me. I don't care what anyone says. I had it by at least by 1 point. Burns got enough of the early rounds in there. I just don't know what the judges are watching. And Laurence Cole, I think Burns should have accidentally punched him in the face by mistake. Yeah? Grabbed his arm, he should have swung a punch, man. So I'll tell you that Laurence Cole was terrible. It was the most disgraceful referee I've seen since the Oxlade Castillo fight. It was Oxlade Castillo versus Celia Brackett's fight. For fight fans, listen, go check that fight. Go watch Mickey Van and see what I'm talking about. It was grabbing. It wasn't as bad as that, but he was doing that sort of thing. And it's very dangerous. And they used to do it in the 60s. The referees to move the guy's gloves when they were up close to try and keep the action flowing for the fight fans watching. But Laurence Cole, yeah, like Girl said, boy, he's just going to continue getting assignments and continue doing what he's doing. But for me, Burns won the fight, and Coleman Funky Dino, he continues to go with it. We still got Burns. Hey, Burns' career, he's still got some legs on his career. Maybe he'll get another fight in the States, you know? We'll see where it goes. So that's all I've got to say on that.
Man, listen, why would he want to come to the States giving away what we're down Saturday night, Saturday afternoon?
We're not Texas. We'll just make sure it's not Texas, innit? Maybe Burns fights the winner out of Linares. I think Kevin Mitchell's got a good shot against Linares. If he gets through, maybe they have a rematch. So that maybe he fights that, you know? But Burns, definitely his career is still alive, you know? For me, I think he got robbed. He needed that fight, but, the referee was disgraceful. That's all I can say. But I'll let someone else burn.
Yeah, I'm gonna go to the rest of the panel here. Jay Deals, I'm gonna start with you. Then you, boxing addict Sean, what you need? I'm gonna just shut up and let y'all talk about it. Speak on what y'all saw that Saturday night with Figueroa and Burns and the incompetence of Laurence Cole. I'll just shut up and let y'all go.
Yeah, well, I'll go on this one then. I thought it was just a disgrace from start to finish, actually.
He'll win, but they'll get a decision to Figueroa. And I also will say...
Jay Dills, Boxing Daddy was talking first, bro.
Yeah, do you want to go, man, or you're all right?
Boxing Daddy, I think you should continue, mate.
Yeah, I'll continue. So, he was basically fighting, you know, three people in that ring, wasn't he? I mean, to begin with, Figueroa came in overweight. Now, Burns is a lightweight. He was coming in there light anyway. They brought Burns in to basically bring in a name that Figueroa could look good against and demolish. And he didn't do it because Burns is actually a good fighter. Took a lot of stick over the years, Burns. But, you know, as I said last week, he's actually been in there with Crawford. He's been in there with Beltran, and he's lasted 12 rounds with both of them and done okay, you know. So Burns brought more to this fight than I think they expected, but Laurence Cole was just a disgrace. You know, like people have touched on, he was pulling at his arm while he's fighting, and that's just dangerous. You know, as a referee, you either pull the arm away, you either split them up or you let them fight. You don't go in there while they're fighting and pull an arm away. You know, Figueroa could have got him with a right hook every time he's pulling at his arm. It was disgraceful, really. And I thought it was probably 7-5 to Figueroa or 6 rounds all. But he shouldn't have had any points taken away. Figueroa was rushing in with his head. He was rabbit punching constantly. And Burns looked the better boxer whenever he was allowed to box. So yeah, it was a horrible night for Burns, really, but I think Burns came out of it a winner more than anything. Figueroa just showed himself to be a bit of a plodder to me.
Jay Dill?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Alright, the fight went exactly how I predicted it last week on the show, where Burns would give Figueroa that work, and I would say more likely in my eyes he would win, but they'll get a decision to Figueroa. But I didn't know Laurence Cole was the referee in this fight. If I knew that, then I would call some bullshit on this fight. But a part of me is not feeling that bad about it because of some of the gift decisions that Ricky Burns got in the past that were egregious in a way.
That's a good point, you know. That's a very good point.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Are we talking about the karma train coming back to hit him?
Yeah.
You know, karma could be a bitch sometimes, you know, but... But the point is this, man. Like, that's not good for boxing, not on no station like CBS and stuff. Mm. It justifies the casuals on saying, this is why I don't watch boxing. Because why make boxing like the NBA, where it looks like you got the refs on your payroll and just getting you out of shit? And I just have to say, like, kudos to Ricky Burns. He showed me that he's above a media hype C-level fighter, and even at 140. So I'm more excited to see what's next for Ricky Burns than I am with Figueroa. And to be honest with you, I thought this was going to be the fight of the day and the night. It didn't become that, but it was good action pace. But Laurence Cole kind of fucked up the flow, and it kind of reminded me of Moreno versus Morris in a way, but not completely. But at the end of the day, Laurence Cole, he's deeply connected, and if I know that guy is refereeing a fight, I ain't watching the fight. I'm just going to be completely honest. And the boxing was good at some points, but then it was a bit dirty and it was kind of unfair. And at the end of the day, I don't condone that as a fan. So, you know, we need more integrity in boxing than that. And that's all I got to say.
Sean, what you need? Your thoughts?
Well, I was wrong. Figueroa won that fight. The problem with the refereeing wasn't so much that the referee was knocking down the hands of the guys to keep them from tying up. It was that he was biased in whose hands he was knocking down. Same thing with guys leading in with their head. He was biased towards Figueroa. Burns, when he would push his weight down on Figueroa and he would get him to the ropes, the ref would just break him and actually warn Burns for doing that, which was, he wasn't doing anything wrong, you know. So the ref kept on seeming to me to warn Burns for things that Figueroa was doing and allow Figueroa to do certain things. And we could say, okay, the ref is trying to help out Burns because Figueroa, because he's the lighter fighter in there, like what happened with Pacquiao and Mayweather. But in fact, in this case, Figueroa is the bigger guy. So everything that the Laurence Cole was doing was blatantly biased. And people who don't know anything about boxing watching this fight, they're going to be saying, well, what's going on here? You know? So it was, I think that aspect of it was the stinker in the whole thing. There was a lot of action. I think that Omar Figueroa, he kept on punching Burns. I don't think it was effective because his head would be in Burns' chest and he'd be punching above his head and all these crazy things he'd be doing. But what I do know is, you know, he was the more active fighter. Of course, because of the referee's involvement. But like I said all the time, I'll say it again, if you're going to go into a fight, you know, when you're negotiating a fight, you should know who's the referee and you should make your, you know, make your presence, make your make your protest in advance, because you're in these negotiations, you need to protest about certain things in advance. But I think Ricky Burns being on that PBC card and people seeing Ricky Burns fight, I think it's going to give him a lot of exposure, and if people ask for him to see him again, he'll be seen again, just like with Chavez versus, what's that guy's name, Brandon Rios. Everybody, I think public opinion feels that Chavez won that fight, shouldn't have been DQ'd, you know, and they wanted to see Chavez again, so he fought Timothy Bradley. I think we'll see Ricky Burns again because he put on a hell of a performance. He fought his heart out with what he was allowed to do, and I think based on that, we're going to see him again. You know, I'm eating crow, but I'm happy still because I realized Ricky Burns wasn't done. Everybody was saying he was done. You know, Figueroa would run over him. Figueroa's the younger guy. But we all know now Ricky Burns handled Figueroa, and if the referee didn't step in, we know Burns would have won that fight, yep. Hands down. So I'm happy about it. I eat my crow, but I'm happy about it at the same time. I think we'll see Ricky Burns again.
Quickly, Sean.
You know, I mean, this is just a long-standing trend with Texas. So, you know, no one can be expected to see a fair fight without some controversy on a card that happens there. So, I mean, you know, people can't be too surprised. It's been this way for a long time. We know fighters that were based in Texas always had lots of support and lots of background or backing from the commission. And, you know, I mean, the trend continues. So, you know, no surprises there. If you don't want to see it, then just don't pay for fights that happen in Texas.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So I want to, since we're kind of running long here, I'm going to split the other fights that went down and just ask specific individual their analysis of a specific fight. I'll go to you on this one, EJ. Break down the undercard of the PBC on CBS card. Jamie McDonnell's win over Tomoki Kameda, which I personally thought it was a very entertaining fight, a real technical chess match back and forth. Your thought, I'll add you in this as well, J-Dill, EJ and J-Dill, your thoughts on McDonald's, as far as I'm concerned, very good win over Tomoki Kameda.
Yeah, hey, listen, that was the fight of the night for me. I don't know about anyone else. For me, that was the fight of the night. I bet money on McDonald's, and he came through. When I went to the betting office, hold on a minute, he's the champion. How comes the odds are so favored against Kameda? But I understand why. He undefeated, he's former champion, and yada yada. Jet Burn, McDonald, maybe they feel like, say, he hasn't fought in himself. So I said, you know what, I'm going to put some money down on the champion, and I'm going to see what goes on. I gambled pretty well. But what I said last week, I did pick Kameda, but I put my money down on McDonald. And McDonald, to me, he definitely did what. Listen, that kid came back from the floor to get back up and to really come back on Kameda. That was. Listen, mate, that's when you know the heart of a champion. You know, he done a UK proud that day. And you know what the worst thing about it? When it was happening live over here, I was watching it on the screen. Yeah, he was coming to mute himself, right?
When I was mute your mic, right quick, J-Dale. Mute your mic.
The worstest thing is when I was watching it on the stream. I was thinking, why ain't Sky Sports? Because Sky Sports are with Andy Joshua cards at the same time, so they should have showed it. They should just cut what they were doing and showed live footage of the McDonald fight. And now what they did is they showed it later on. They showed it live of the Burns fight, but we missed the McDonald fight. We got it later on, so we already knew the verdict before. This is in the UK. But I'm telling you, McDonald, he put on a really good show. He showed that he's definitely a he definitely is a champion. And the comedian, man, I'm telling you, a lot of people in Texas, they actually feel like Kameda won the fight. To me, I don't think so. I mean, like, you could argue, people could argue it's a draw, but I think McDonald the champion, you know, you really have to take it from the champion, the knockdown, yeah. But if you look at all the knockdown, McDonald really put it on him, some good inside work, some outside work, and Kameda looked like he was struggling because, you know, Kameda usually has things his own way. But he was in a fight, man, and McDonald came to fight. McDonald was a taller guy, stronger, and he really won. And he showed, with all these veteran skills and all the things McDonald's been through in the past, but he showed, man, at that day that he deserved to be the champion. And you know what? It was fitting. It was a one-point victory. And, yeah, man, it was great for McDonald. And, he, you know, I don't know. I think they're talking about a Kameda rematch. Hopefully it's going to be over in the UK or some neutral ground. Or he may move up. I think he said it's easy for him. He's going to win again. I'm sure he'll be an underdog. I'm going to put money. Anyone listening, put money down on McDonald, man. I'm sure he's going to be a big underdog again. And it was a good fight. But just the card in general was very good. You know what? The PBC card is stepping up. And that was a great win for us in the UK. And I thoroughly enjoyed myself. So it was a great card for me. So that's what I've got to say about the card.
J-Dills, quickly, your thoughts on McDonald's win over Kameda.
Like, the first two rounds, I felt like McDonald was controlling the range and everything. Kameda would still get his jab going. But the third round, when he fainted hard on McDonald, feigning him to think he was going low for a body shot, and he threw a looping right hand like Marcus Madonna did to Adrian Broner, and threw that vicious right hand, and seeing McDonald fall on the mat like that, I was like, God damn. And then McDonald just gets up and just says shit, dang shit, and just come back to that boy and just start waiting for him to throw some punches, extend his punches so he could counter him easily. And McDonnell, he was the bigger guy in this fight. He's a guy that starts kind of slow, but, you know, I saw his game plan. He was going to shift it to another gear in the second half of the fight. That's exactly what he did. He broke down Kameda's body. He was starting to throw more and more punches, more hooks, more right hands, more 2-3 punch combinations. But Kameda did his work too, but they were mostly hitting elbows and gloves, and sometimes they would land a flush. But, man, if this was a 15-round fight, Kameda would have got knocked the fuck out because he looked like he was about to go in the 12th round. And, man, that was the fight of the night. And this is at bantamweight. I can't wait to see what McDonald's going to do next. And Kameda is a hell of a fighter, too. You could tell he was in shape for this one. I mean, you could tell he has control. I mean, he has control issues from outside range, but and he has a bad habit trying to come in, lunging in with his head and stuff. But other than that, you know, Kameda, he's a quick cat. He got hand speed, and I would love to see who he go up against next. But McDonnell, I see why he's the champ. He's very poised, very calm, and he could take it to another gear when he has to. I don't see that as a robbery. I see that as the champ took the fight from the challenger. So that's what I got to say about that fight.
I'll go to you on this one, Boxing Addict. And Sean, Anthony Joshua over the weekend destroyed Raphael Love in 2 rounds.
Made him a Brazilian steakhouse.
Right. Your thoughts on the progress of Anthony Joshua, Boxing Addict, and Sean. And talk about his upcoming fight against Kevin Johnson.
Yeah, well, Joshua did his business as he always does. He was looking big and strong in there, and I think this guy was the sort of number one heavyweight in Brazil, which doesn't really mean much, does it? But he went in there and blew him out. He's now preparing for this Johnson fight, which is going to be a really decent test for him, I think. You know, Johnson always gives it a bit of bluster, and he was there at the fight afterwards. Causing a bit of a kerfuffle, getting the crowd angry and stuff, which is all good. It'll make it a decent fight, and Johnson will probably stay in there for 6 or 7 rounds, I'd imagine. It'll be crafty, but I think Joshua will end up taking him out. I just wanted to touch on the McDonald fight, because I think from what they're talking about now, McDonald's willing to go over to fight Yamanaka in Japan, which will be fantastic. McDonald deserves to be called a champion.
Hey, McDonald's a G, bro. I'm on that.
Sean's eyebrows raised there. I'm with him on that.
That's good. Go ahead, man. I'm listening.
It is.
Yeah, I'm sorry for interrupting, but I like that matchup.
Yeah,
that'd be fantastic, because, you know, McDonald's proved that, you know, although he's the WBA regular champion, he's proved he's a champion. He's gone over there and beaten Kameda. I know the WBO belt wasn't on the line, but he thoroughly deserves to be called a champion. And McDonald is strong as hell at the weight. I mean, he got put down there, but you know what? He came back, and he does that in his fights. He's very strong, and he's relentless throwing his punches. So going over there and fighting Yamanaka, if he does it, fair play to him. That'd be a brilliant fight.
Flipping hell, man. That'd be fly. Hey, listen, mate. I'm sure he'd be the underdog in that one. I've met him, actually. I met him in... He was undercard of Frotch Groves, too, when I went there.
I did as well, actually, in the Hilton, yeah.
Yeah. I met him, like, he's tall for the weight, and he's on it. He's very determined, so... Yeah, man, that sounds really good. Against Yamanaka, that breakdown would be great. Yeah, that's good to hear. Thanks, Bob, for that.
Yeah, I know Yamanaka's Sean's guy, so he'll have something to say about that one.
Yeah.
Sean, your thoughts on Anthony Joshua's win? If you want to, quick mention about this proposed battle between McDonald and Yamanaka.
You know, I mean, we know that Joshua is just, like, working up the ladder, building his brand, you know, trying to make exciting fights, sort of doing the Tyson thing, right? You know, through the bums and making some exciting knockouts and building his brand. So it's nice to see he's going to finally fight a guy who, you know, I mean, people think is going to be a tough test for him, sort of a gatekeeper. But I think he's looking too big, really, a little too bulky, you know, a little too stiff. I don't know how that's going to play for him in the long run. You know, I mean, you can see he's really putting on the muscle. And I think, you know, long term, that might not be beneficial, especially for, like, endurance and stuff, once he starts fighting, like, top-level caliber guys and he needs to go a few rounds. You know, I think that could be a negative on him. But we will see. I mean, it's good to see him get in there with a tough guy who's selling the fight. I mean, I don't know if he's going to go that far with him, but it'll be interesting until something bigger comes along. I mean, you know, it's exciting that the heavyweight division has quite a few good young fighters coming up, and we just have to see how it works out and hopefully get some of them in the ring together. And Yamanaka, you know, I'm disappointed. I was hoping he was going to step up to fight Rigo. But, no, I mean, any good fight for Yamanaka, it's good. You know, I mean, he's one of those long-reigning champs that nobody really knows about. So, you know, good on him.
Yeah. And quickly, Gail, and what you need, your thoughts on Michael Soro's kind of surprising stoppage over Glenn Tapia.
You know,
surprising to some, yeah.
Yeah, Soro. Funny enough, I had seen Soro up at the summit.
Michel Soro. Excuse me, Gail. I pronounced his real name.
Michel Soro. Yeah. And it's funny because Abel Sanchez, who does not train him, but allows Soro and his trainer to work out at the summit, as he often does with fighters, was talking about the wide range of backgrounds of the guys up there. And he says, oh, I've even got this guy from the Congo. Well, he was sort of off on the country. But Soro is, you know, the next biggest guy in size to Soro is Triple G. So Soro, you know, towers over a lot of the other guys at the summit. And watching him, I thought, this guy's really impressive. And sure enough, he took Tapia apart. What a victory. That guy is now on everyone's radar, and good for him. I love it when someone comes out of nowhere like that. I do like Glenn Tapia. I felt bad for him, and you could tell he was in absolute shock over the whole thing. But good for Soro. He's on the map, and I look forward to seeing him again.
What you need? What you need? Are you there?
He's on mute. Okay. He's on mute. Hey, before he jumps in, let me just say about Joshua. You know, over in the UK, yeah, Joshua, like Sean said, he looks bulky. Definitely looked too stiff. And in that match with Kimping Johnson, I'm telling you, bro, if he starts going some rounds, bro, all that muscle is that's going to go against you. You know, I've talked to some experts about boxing. You know, it's not necessarily like a big muscular build is the best for boxing. Usually a flexible build. And I tell you what, man, if he starts going some rounds and Joshua can't land, yeah, because Joshua's used to land at least about 90% of his punches. Now, when you're fighting Kimping, you're probably going to land about 65%, like, probably around that range, yeah. And it's going to be very hard for him to land it. And it's a 10-rounder. So, boy, you know what? I'm not saying Kevin Johnson's going to win the fight. But I'll tell you what, when he starts going to deep waters, you know, the Kimping's been against guys. Not even Vitaly Klitschko could take him out. And some of the top level, you know, he loses the very top level is Kevin Johnson. So we're going to see what Joshua's made of. But I'll tell you what, that should be a good fight. But Joshua, boy, you know, it's out there. People saying, you know, he's like the Frank Bruno, but we'll see. But in my opinion, you know, Kev, don't be surprised if Kevin takes this round and Joshua looks real tired. And he'd be lucky if he finishes, especially if he starts fast as well. But that's just my opinion on that. Go ahead, what you need. You can unmute yourself, my man. There you go.
What is it? I stepped away for a minute.
A quick analysis of Soro's win over Glenn Tapia.
Oh. Well, in short, I was watching Glenn Tapia after the fight. He was disappointed.
Mute yourself, J.D. We're getting an echo here, so.
Go ahead.
Let me be brief. Glenn Tapia, when I listened to his interview afterwards, two things I admired about him. He admitted that he lost, and he knew that he also knew that what he did wrong. It seems as though Tapia went into that fight with weight drain problems because he couldn't make weight, remember, at the weigh-in? And then he came in afterwards. He said that he was a little sluggish even throughout the fight. But that's not an excuse. He said he lost. I think that he still has deficiencies in how his defense, even though he has knowledge about defense, but I noticed he wasn't established. He wasn't maintaining distance with Soro. His offense was pretty good. You know, he was feinting well, mixing up his shots in the beginning. But I noticed that defensively, I don't know why, but he was ignoring. He said Soro caught him with a good right, and he was like, he was wondering why he wasn't moving out of the way of the shots and a lot of things. So seems as though he had weight issues, and that affected his performance somewhat. But I'm still impressed with Soro. I think Soro did an excellent job. Feinted him, counter right, left hook, beautiful stuff. Took him out of the game. It was good stuff.
I'm going to split the news segment up again. I'm going to you on this one, Sean and Gail. We found out last week that Tony Ayala Jr. Passed away, I believe, last week on Thursday at the age of 52. I'm kind of old enough to barely remember Ayala when he was coming up somewhat. Ayala was a rising junior middleweight contender in the early 80s, on the verge of a title shot until he was got in trouble with the law, convicted of rape, I believe it was, went away for a number of years. He was fighting demons even as he was on his rise to the top, or on his rise to a potential title shot against Duran, I believe it was. Either Duran or Davey Moore, I can't remember. I believe it was Davey Moore. He made a brief comeback in the 90s, I believe it was. I know he fought, I can't remember who he fought, but he made a brief comeback. Nothing really never came of it.
Your boy Campus.
Thanks, EJ. I believe he lost that fight. Sean, Gail, talk about the kind of troubled life in and out of the ring of Tony Ayala Jr. Because, a little bit of brief background. People were putting him at his best. They were putting him on the level of a Duran, of a Hearns, of a Leonard and Hagler. They was putting him on that lot, calling him the potential future superstar. And then for his career and really life to end up the way it did, it was just sad, really. Sean, Gail? Anyone? He's giving it to you, Gail. Unmute your mic, please.
I'll talk about it.
Sorry about that. I had to find the mic quickly. Well, you know, as it happens, talent doesn't always keep people out of trouble all by itself. And Ayala Jr. was convicted of rape and spent quite a few years in prison and seemed to have his life turned around, you know, after a long, long time in prison, got out, was running a gym. And now it looks like, according to police reports, he had been using heroin, and I think we have a very sad end to the story.
Sean? Unmute your mic, Sean.
Yep, I'm off. So, yeah, I mean, it's like everybody's been mentioning. He's another one of those fighters with potential and skill as a young fighter that people had high hopes for, but the streets, the environment, you know, the things that he grew up in were just too much of a lure for him and just pulled him down. I mean, you know, he's a lot like Johnny Tapia, right? You know, guys that had skill and ability and were tough, skilled fighters, but, you know, drugs and other issues just sort of ruined their career. I mean, you know, Aaron Pryor, an all-time great, and Pernell Whitaker, you know, so many great fighters, you know, coming from tough backgrounds, growing up in an environment where all this stuff is around them, and I mean, you know, they're normal people, so they're not, they're not protected from the things around them, you know, so a lot of them befall these negative things that happen, you know, being shot, falling in with the wrong people, falling with drugs, so, you know, I mean, nobody would say it's an unexpected ending for him, but it's sad nonetheless, you know, to seem like you're sort of turning your life around and continue to have these problems. These demons still haunt you, which, I mean, is normal. A lot of the people that have these issues with addiction and other issues, you know, it's an ongoing life issue that they have to deal with. So, you know, there's always ups and downs. So it's too bad.
Well, and it's a commentary, a social commentary about what's going on in the United States with heroin becoming so common. That is the drug of the American suburbs these days. It's a situation I hate to say I know all too well through some family members. You know, when I was the age where people were getting involved with that stuff, you know, years ago, heroin is the last thing you would ever expect you'd hear anybody, you know, in your casual circle getting involved with. That was scary, scary, extreme stuff. Now, it's the norm. It's the cheapest, you know, narcotic painkiller around. People who get hooked on prescription drugs and then can't get to them or can't afford them anymore turn to heroin because it's so damn cheap and it's easy to get. And particularly here in the southwest part of the U.S., and he was in San Antonio, it's really, really easy to get because it comes across the border. It's really a scary situation, and these stories should remind all of us what's going on out there for a pretty sizable generation of Americans.
Indeed it is, and indeed it is really sad to what you mentioned about heroin, Alice. The popularity is the wrong word, the rise of the use of heroin all over the country, particularly in the suburbs, especially in the Midwest, too. I'll go to you on this one. Jay Dale, what you need. Deontay Wilder set to make his first defense of the WBC heavyweight title in his home state of Alabama against Eric Molina. June 13th, I believe the date is in Birmingham, Alabama. The bout will be aired on Showtime. Your thoughts on Wilder's, his initial defense of the title against Molina. First of all, Jay Dale, your thoughts? Unmute your mic, please.
Showcase fight, that's all I got to say. He's going to make Alabama style. Thank you very much.
What you need?
Same here.
And we move on. I'll go to you on this one, EJ and Mr. Boxing Addict. The saga of Kid Galahad. Recently suspended 2 years, tested positive for stanozol, which is a steroid, in September. He says that his brother spiked his drink. He's going to fight it. His brother's in jail for another crime. Since you're over there in the UK, talk about this saga because this doesn't make much sense to me. What is going on?
Go ahead, Boxing. I'll go after you. Go ahead, mate.
No, you go for it, mate, because I don't know a great deal about this one. I only heard
I'll just go what I heard in it. Basically, he had a dispute with his brothers, and they were taking some supplements, and basically, they done it deliberately. They put something in his drink, and he got tested positive for a substance, which was banned in the UK. So, consequently, he's banned for 2 years. It's a shame, though, because, you know, who's on the verge of Quigg, Frampton, and, you know, he's European in that mix. And now he's obviously banned for 2 years. They're going to appeal. Hopefully they win the appeal. And, you know, I think 2 years is too strong. Come on. And it depends what the drug did. I don't know how he really needs the drug. He doesn't really need the drug. He's in great shape as it is, but it was as a bad substance. So they probably win the appeal. I don't think it's nothing to do with nothing. But to be honest with you, I think they'll probably win the appeal, in my opinion. But, you know, I want to touch on the Deontay Wilder thing, yeah? Look, people were saying he's fighting that guy. Why is he fighting that guy? He's the WBC champion, and then he's coming off with a broken fist. So, you know, you don't want to throw him in there. I mean, when they tried to assassinate Kell Brook, they didn't just throw him straight in the lines after he beat Sean Porter. They gave him JoJo Dan. So, you know, for me, he gets a pass is Deontay Wilder. I don't know about show. It should be a showcase, but we'll see how his hand wraps up because, you know, his best hand is his right hand, and that's the hand that broke off Stiverne's head. So we'll see how that goes on. So for me, very interested. But going back to Gallahan, Kid Gallahan, hopefully they win the appeal, and he won't be banned for 2 years because it doesn't make no sense. He doesn't need drugs to make him he is, you know what I'm saying? So that's just my opinion. Go ahead, boxing at it.
Yeah, Galahad's a really decent fighter, so it's a shame that this has come out, really. Quite surprising as well, because he's out of the Ingle gym, and that's not something that they would, you know, have their fighters doing, so I'm not sure of the story on it. Yeah, hopefully it won't be 2 years. They can appeal it, and they'll be back in the ring soon. He's a very decent fighter, and he doesn't need it, you know. And quickly on Deontay Wilder, it's just a terrible fight, isn't it? I mean, Lena got blown out by Ariola in the round, didn't he? So, yeah, not sure about that one. Bit of a showcase by my advisor, so.
I mean, look, it's nothing, you know. Sean was mentioning in the chat here, in the private chat here on G+, that there's nothing wrong with that. And I agree with him on this. Look, what you're trying to do is up the profile for Deontay Wilder until he lands a big fight, maybe against Klitschko, maybe against Fury, whoever the winner of that fight will be. He is becoming the emerging American face of boxing once Floyd Mayweather eventually retires. That's the deal. And you put him on Showtime, you give him a platform, you give him a main event fighter, and you build up his stature until he becomes... And I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Americans love American heavyweight champions, and they will ride with him until, even though Klitschko is the champion, what you do is you put Deontay Wilder in fights like this. He looks impressive. Fans, mainstream fans, or general sports fans, casual boxing fans, they'll look at him and keep an eye on him. Who is this guy? He looks pretty good. They may not know a lot of him about like that. May not know a lot of him in terms of substance wise, but he's a guy they'll say he's a guy to keep his eye on. Is he good enough to fight Klitschko? Maybe he's good enough to beat Klitschko. In fights like this, that's what it does for Deontay Wilder. It just builds up his profile. And to Sean's point in the private chat, at this point in time, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that at all. Any last comments before we go to the previews of what's happening this weekend? And again, we move on. Let's move on to previewing the fights that's happening this weekend. The fights I want to focus on is the doubleheader on HBO, happening at the Forum in Inglewood. HBO on HBO May 16th on Saturday. Headline, of course, by Gennady Golovkin fighting Willie Monroe. Willie Monroe Jr. Golovkin defending his belts, well, his WBA belt mainly. I go see him in this one, Gail, since this fight is happening in your neck of the woods, and I think you've been coverage on the fight. In your thoughts, what's the vibe out there in Inglewood? Golovkin is becoming a real attraction out there in Southern California. He's packing the joint out at StubHub Center. It's anticipated he's going to get a really good crowd at the Forum Saturday night. Your thoughts on Golovkin and Willie Monroe?
Well, it looks like the Forum is going to be a sellout. It's darn close. When I talked to Tom Loeffler on Tuesday, I said, are you going to have a sellout? He was hedging, but as of yesterday, I think he felt a little more confident and said, yeah, I think it does look like it's going to be a sellout. So that's a little north of 12,000 seats. Interestingly enough, you're also starting to hear the celebrity chatter about, oh, I'm going to be at the big fight Saturday night. And, you know, you expect the Mario Lopez's of the world to show up. I mean, he kind of shows up at everything, right? But you're starting to hear talk about guys like Eddie Murphy showing up, which is very interesting.
Well, Eddie Murphy, he's a huge boxing fan. Most folks don't know that. He has quite a fight collection.
It's been a long time since you've heard people in the Los Angeles area talk about going to fights this way. There's been a lot of activity all week. There is no better promotion team as far as publicity than K2 and their crew. They know exactly what to do. And Golovkin knows how to be fan-friendly outside the ring just as much as inside the ring. So he throws a pitch out at the Dodgers game on Monday night. And one of his fanboys is Adrian Gonzalez on the Dodgers. You know, go figure. So they pose together for pictures and everyone mobs them, and it's crazy. Media got credentialed just to cover the first pitch, and they left. Big turnout for his news conference Tuesday and his workout Wednesday. They had a day off today. They'll do the weigh-in. I was giving him grief, saying, oh, what are you going to do in case it rains? It's not going to rain. But what if it rains? It's not going to rain. It's going to rain. So we'll see what kind of crowd. They're going to have to move the weigh-in instead of the parking lot, big public weigh-in. They'll move it inside. It will still be a public weigh-in. That will be very interesting to see who shows up at a free public weigh-in at the forum. Monroe is talking big. I give him a lot of credit. The man did step up and said, you know, I'm betting on myself. I'm going to see what I can do. He's a southpaw. This is Golovkin's first southpaw opponent since he laid Proxa flat 3 years ago. He said he wants to work with a southpaw. He wanted to test himself against the southpaw. So you think, all right, who's he looking at in the future that's a southpaw? Well, maybe in the immediate future, Andy Lee. It's an interesting question for all of us to think about. The betting line apparently has Golovkin so far ahead that to win $100, you'd have to bet $4,500. That's how much of a favorite the odds makers have him. Yeah, which is kind of funny. If he gets a knockout in this fight, he will pass Mike Tyson's record for knockouts in a row. And he wants it. He says he's going for it. He goes for it every fight. How much of a test Monroe will give him? Of course, we all don't think much, but I like Monroe's attitude. I like his trainer's attitude, Tony Morgan. They say that they've watched Golovkin's opponents. They've picked out some things they did wrong. They are looking for mistakes. The one thing that Tony Morgan, Monroe's trainer, said is, well, you know, Golovkin's opponents all stand right in front of him, and that's why they get hit, and we're not going to do that. Well, Golovkin's opponents do not stand in front of him. Golovkin cuts off the ring, corners them, and wails on them. That's what happens. So it's usually not voluntary. We'll see what happens in the fight. They always put on a good show. They always make a spectacle of it. The lights, the music, all the accoutrements that go with the entertainment portion of the fights, which is also what makes him so appealing. And I heard him a week ago talking about what he was going to wear in the ring. And he said, what are the Lakers' colors? And one of his guys said purple and gold. So last fight, he walked in Los Angeles Dodgers blue and white. He'll be walking in Lakers purple and gold on Saturday night. That's the way these guys think. At the long time home of the Lakers, the forum.
I want to go to what you mean on this. Gail, during her breakdown, she mentioned that Golovkin is fighting in Monroe to work on some things. We were part of what you mean. You and I was part of EJ Boxing Live's show last Sunday, and you mentioned essentially the same thing, that he's facing a Willie Monroe to work on a few things to see what he can do against a particular style. Piggyback on what Gail mentioned during her breakdown, and expand on what you were saying Sunday about how even though Golovkin is the favorite, big time favorite, that he's facing Monroe to figure out how to deal with a particular style. What you need? Unmute your mic.
Basically, the slick boxer style, basically, he's looking at. I guess it would be sort of like the Cuban style of boxing. You know, like what you could say hypothetically, what would happen if Arislandi Lara was to face Gennady Golovkin, I guess. The thing about it is, like I was saying, Golovkin is effective at infighting. Sort of infighting, close range, and also mid-range, right? You know, a lot of times people talk about cutting off the ring, but Manny Pacquiao, though some people will disagree with me, he actually did cut off the ring against Floyd Mayweather. But and Canelo at certain points in time later on in the fight also cut off the ring against Arislandi Lara. The problem with counter punches is even if you do cut them off, a smart counter puncher can still actually use that to set a trap for you and counter you and then roll out. The same defensive maneuver is the same maneuver you use to also counter your opponent. So while Gennady Golovkin uses feints to get inside, you know, he uses the feints, he stays on the outside, sort of like Marcos Maidana. In fact, now that I think about it, Triple G's a more accurate Marcos Maidana. Yeah, sort of. Kind of. But anyway, you know, he feints you. When you throw, that's when Triple G comes in, counters, and then he shifts in, and he starts working on you, you know, with those hammer punches, all this way, you know. So let's see what Monroe can do in terms of, is he slick enough? Does he understand how to roll at certain angles? Because if Triple G can't get him out of there, now we saw what happened with Martin Murray, right, who's a reasonably good boxer. So let's see what Monroe can do in terms of style, because Monroe, if he may not have the experience like Triple G, he may not have fought the level of opposition as Triple G, but he has a style which definitely can give Triple G problems. But of course, it depends on his maturity, it depends on his experience. He doesn't have the level of opposition Gennady Golovkin has faced. He hasn't had to go through the difficulties Gennady Golovkin has had to face with different opponents. So that's why I say he has a very high uphill battle to climb against Triple G. Because Triple G is not just, he doesn't just implement the style that Abel Sanchez has. Triple G was an Olympic champion, which means he's actually very proficient and very skilled in boxing, period. So when you combine those two things together, that's what kind of makes him so difficult to beat at this point in time, because he takes his time to break down a fighter, he takes his time to come in on a fighter, he assesses a fighter to see how his style can match up to that fighter. That's Triple G. He can fight going backwards, he just doesn't do it with the style that he has. But you can look at some of his earlier fights and see him fighting backwards and so on, right? So Willie Monroe could pose some kind of problem to Triple G, then Triple G has to adjust to that style. If Monroe can adapt to Triple G's style, if he can change up different looks, change the way how he approaches the fight as the fight progresses, sort of be a step ahead of Triple G, that's a high task, but if he can be, it could really make this fight very interesting. And Triple G may win by unanimous decision, but he may not stop Monroe. You know what I mean? So it depends on what, let me see here. Okay. It depends on what, really it's about what does Monroe bring to the table. He works with Victor Conte's SNAC, so he's going to be in peak physical shape. But the question will be not so much his physical shape and conditioning, it'll be what is his fight plan for Triple G. So that's what we have to see.
I'll go to the rest of the panel quickly. EJ, Boxing Addict, J. Dill, Sean. Quickly, your thoughts on this fight between Triple G and Willie Monroe.
Yeah, let me go first, Jay. Let me go quick. Man, it should be a good fight. Yeah, man. I think Willie Monroe is going to win this time, yeah. No, I'm not even going to do that. I love my lesson. Triple G's gonna put on a show. Willie's gonna try his best, and you know what? He's got the pedigree. His father, you know, beat Marvin Hagler, and they've upset in his family. So you know what I mean? I'm not gonna say like he'll put on a good show. He does move a bit, but it's good though, because a lot of people have been saying and Dan would give Triple G some trouble. So we'll see how Triple G is going to deal with a guy who moves a lot, who can give him some trouble, some angles, but eventually he's going to cut him down and cut him to shreds. I've heard in the press conference, I've never heard William Monroe in what I've heard say that they're going to win the fight. They heard they're going to give him trouble, we're going to give him angles, he ain't fighting no more, but they ain't saying what I want to hear. I ain't saying, I'm going to beat you, blah, blah, emphatically and confidence in them. They're just saying, we're going to give you trouble, but then no one's saying they're going to win. So I think in their minds, they're looking to try and maybe bring Triple G in deep waters, and maybe that's what their strategy is. But that's not a recipe for winning. And like Gil said, the knockout streak is on the thing. So he's going to try and knock out. You know, that is a great thing what Gil put up about the Lakers colors. You know, I'm a big basketball fan. So that would endear him to the crowd even more, make him make people come out to want to see him. He's fan friendly. He's a nice guy. And you know what? He's going to do a knockout probably late in the late rounds, maybe. But Willie's going to try his best. But it should be a good showcase. Quickly on the Chocolito fight as well.
Save it. We're going to talk about that next. Save it.
I want to say that he fought Martin Murray. I mean, Martin Murray is a tough guy, but that fight could have gone the distance with Martin Murray. Okay? So, and Martin Murray is not a great puncher. So just think about that. Keep that in your mind, in the back of your mind, as you're, we'll see what happens.
I didn't finish what I was saying.
Yeah, what I'm saying is that, okay, I'm going back to Triple G, what I'm saying is that, you know, a lot of guys come in, but really and truly, you know, I know things well. I was looking at Triple G's amateur career with, like, nearly 300 fights with only probably 11 losses. His amateur career is stellar. He's just the ultimate professional. He's got a great knockout percentage. I honestly think that you can't live with this dude in this division. None of them can. And William Monroe is probably looking to just probably do something like what something like Bone Crusher Smith did to Mike Tyson. And hold for the rest of your life. That's what you're gonna do. You're gonna try and hold for dear life and try and squeak out a 12-team. But any other way, I don't see him. So that's what I'm gonna say.
J Dill, boxing addict Sean, quickly your thoughts on this one.
Man, if I'm Willie Monroe, I would study what Bernard Hopkins did to Tito Trinidad. You know, step back when you know Golovkin's about to shift his punches, leave with a jab or leave with a front shot and just pretty much clinch him and then reset and turn him around. And then at other times, when Golovkin's not in punching stance, leave with a left hand. And then hold him, turn him around. Keep doing that. You might win some rounds here and there. Problem is, Golovkin is a smart-ass boxer.
Yeah.
And that shit ain't going to work all night. And eventually, Golovkin is going to cut him down, corner him. Moreau is going to eventually get cut off to the point where he's going to have to fight like a man to get out of Hell's Kitchen. And them body shots and that locating jab that Triple G got, that motherfucker's nose is going to bleed. And then Triple G is going to wear him down with his strength because Triple G could clinch in a way. So I'm just thinking about what advantages Moreau has other than lateral movement, head movement. His punches are not going to be effective enough for Triple G to respect his range. And I thought about that too. So, and Triple G got good defense in a way too. So, and Moreau's not a high offensive output fighter. He's very calculated, but he's not Mayweather. So, the point is this, man.
He's not even Lenny Lara either, so.
No, he's not.
So, I just have Triple G getting a TKO probably about the 6th or 7th round. It's going to be an uppercut and a left hook to the body. Game over, Triple G. And that's all I got to say.
Boxing addict, Sean.
Yeah, well, I think K2 have been pretty clever with the whole promotion of this, actually, because they're trying to push it as, you know, Golovkin going in with a different kind of fighter who's going to give him some problems and all this sort of stuff. But I think it's a complete false flag, basically, because Golovkin's been in there with, you know, hundreds of amateurs who have fought similar styles. He's seen it all before. He's going to get in there and work him out within a couple of rounds and absolutely demolish him. That's the way I see it. I don't think we'll give him any more problems than, I don't think Monroe's really at that top level, so unfortunately for him, I think he's just going to be another KO on Golovkin's list, but hopefully he'll give it a go for a few rounds.
Sean? Unmute your mic, Sean.
Yeah. I have to agree with mostly everybody else. I think it's going to be an early night for GGG. But, I think Willie is going to look good in spots. You know, he's got fast hands, and he's going to hit GGG here and there. But he seems to be more of a mid-range fighter, not really an outboxer. So I think a lot of that isn't really going to work to his benefit, because GGG is also a mid-range fighter who controls distance. And he's just going to be able to do it better. And, we know how dangerous he is. Monroe, he's done well against lower-level competition, but never really looked dangerous in doing it. So, I wouldn't expect him to bring anything that was too dangerous to GG. But, it's good. It's another stay-busy fight. He's fighting a lefty, so he's going to be able to work on some stuff and just get comfortable. And then down the road, hopefully it'll just be more sort of experience in his bank for any big fights that he runs into down in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with the overall assessment here. My key is, what happens when Triple G starts to find him with the jab to the head or to the body? You talk about cutting off the ring is important, but the process of cutting Monroe off in the ring starts with the jab. I think once he finds it with the jab, he can get to him with the body shots. He can get to him with that nice little that hook, that and that right hand that EJ talks about with Triple G on top of the head, on the crown of the head. And once he finds those shots, I think he's going to stop William Monroe inside 8 rounds. Let's move on and talk about this final fight. Give EJ, Sean, and myself the floor a bit. We've been talking about Roman Chocolatito Gonzalez for a long while. He finally makes his HBO debut, fighting Edgar Sosa, former champion, I believe Edgar Sosa is. But look, this fight is basically a showcase bout. Edgar Sosa is not the fighter he used to be, I'm looking forward to this fight more than I am towards the Triple G fight. To be honest, that's just me, because to me, Gonzalez, he's in my personal top 10 list of pound for pound best fighters in the world. He's been in there for a while. 3 division world champion. I'll go to you on this one, EJ, then you can follow up, Sean. Talk about it. Chocolatito Gonzalez making his HBO debut in his first fight of a 4-fight deal.
Oh, has he got a deal? He's got a 4-fight deal, yeah? That's definite, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, listen, mate. He's going to put on the show. Hopefully, he doesn't do it too quickly. Hopefully go a couple of rounds so you can see how good defensive is. But his uppercut, right hook, and his left hook and his right hand, yeah, is to me, when I watch him, yeah, it reminds me of a early Roberto Duran in the lightweight division. He's defensively sound. Hands is, for a short guy, he's got very long arms. Soto's not going to put up much of a challenge for what I've seen. I think he's just going to pick him apart and carve him up. Even Akira Agashi, when he took the belt, the WBC flyweight belt, that was supposed to be a test for him. He just carved him apart, man. No one can live with this guy. The only one who can live with him is probably Estrada, them type of guys, and also the...
Estrada, Inoue.
Inoue's higher weight, but in his weight class, they're talking about Annette Romrang and Estrada. They're the only kinds you can try and maybe do a fight, especially with Annette Romrang just beat... the Chinese guy as well, that fits the hand of gold. But you know what? It should be a really good fight. To be honest with you, Michael, he's probably gonna cut him to ribbons, and they're gonna make a big thing about it. So they should. I don't see any of these fights in the weekend lasting long. But the debut of the flyweights is finally on HBO, and hopefully we're gonna get a chance to see all these great little guys in this little weight class. Because to be honest with you, man, their fights are currently fight often. Chocolito, look at his wins. Like, was it 50 odd? And his knockout percentage, and there's people never heard of him before. It's ridiculous. I'm glad they finally brought him over to HBO. Obviously, with the Japanese thing, the tech, and maybe some of the fights will be in Japan as well. Hopefully, HBO can go to Japan. They haven't been there since Mike Tyson days as well. So maybe we get to see some of that fight with the Inoue fight, maybe the new year. Maybe that fight could happen as well. So it's some big times for the flyweight division, and it's good that big time boxing HBO has picked them up, and we're going to see some great fights. I'm looking forward to it.
Sean, you've been on this show for over a year now, probably a year and a half now. And ever since you've been on initially, you talked about the lightweight fighters, and you're a fan of the lightweight fighters like I am and like EJ is. Talk about this fight with Omar Gonzalez, and he's finally getting his time to shine on a super big platform.
No, it's great, right? I mean, this is what true boxing fans want, to see like great fighters who don't get the push that some fighters get. And he's going to be able to come to the States and fight on a huge undercard, you know, headlighted by GGG, who is just like growing every day, selling out places, just going to bigger venues every fight. And now he jumps on. He can piggyback off of him. He's fighting a legitimate fighter. And, I mean, he is a few years past his prime, but with a veteran guy like him, you never know what will happen. I mean, he is a solid fighter, and, I mean, he's beat top-level guys. But like you said, it is set up to be a fight that sort of sells him and for him to look exciting. So they're picking a guy that they think that will be a little easier. But, I mean, Estrada is doing the same thing. He's also going to fight Hawaiian Punch, apparently, in a rematch, and he won the first fight very easy. And that fight probably will be in the States, too. So, you know, they could build up that rematch, which everybody's been so eagerly waiting for. I'm sort of curious, like EJ was saying, what's going to happen now that he signed this new deal, how that's going to affect the Tekken deal that he sort of had, and the fight with Inoue, which a lot of us diehards have really been looking forward to, him moving up for the fourth weight against an exciting Japanese fighter. But regardless of how it plays out, I mean, it's just great to see him there, and it's nice that casual fans are going to be exposed to him. I mean, he's an exciting fighter. A lot like what you need was talking about Canelo. You know, he fights the same. You know, he thinks about what he's doing in the ring. He thinks about the shots he's going to throw, and he breaks it down. I mean, you wouldn't really say he's a devastating one-punch knockout artist, but I mean, he's just so surgical in the way he will break a guy down, up and down, inside. He's right in there, but he's not really catching any shots like solid, you know. And then he just breaks guys down to the point where, you know, there's nothing they can do but just surrender. And a lot of the guys end up going down because of body shots, right? You know, he just breaks them down. And I would think this fight will probably be similar because he is fighting a tough veteran guy. So I would think by round 8 and 9, he'll probably have too much and it'll probably be over. So we will see.
I'll go to you on this one, Jay Dale, and you can follow up what you need. Your thoughts on Chocolatito Gonzalez, how much have you seen of him, your assessment of him as a fighter?
Can I go?
Yeah.
Okay. I saw him versus Leon and Fuentes and stuff. You know, his two current fights. And I seen Edgar Sosa versus the Hawaiian Punch guy. Remember that fight? That's when Sosa only had like 4 losses or something like that. But this is gonna be 3 to 4 round fight. For one, even though Sosa's a boxer and everything, Gonzalez, the only way you're gonna hurt him is you gotta go to the body. That's the only thing he leaves open. It's really that body, but he's so devastating with his left hand, meaning like he could jab you with it quick, he could hit you with the hooks, or he can go hook your body. It's just so devastating. Then the uppercuts, and then the 1-2s with the jab and the right hand. He's just a deadly offensive fighter. He could block shots well. But the thing is, I haven't really seen him fight guys that have good head movement, extreme high ring IQ boxing skills, but these are decent guys who could bang with you with good hand speed, good offense. But so far from what I've seen of Gonzalez, which is like 4 or 5 fights, I must say, like, he's an offensive machine. He's fun to watch. He's devastating. the way he throws his shots. He's pretty accurate. He has good range. I enjoy him, and I think he's going to make easy work of Edgar Sosa, probably 3 to 4 rounds. I predict an uppercut and the right hand is just going to finish Sosa, and that's all I got to say about it.
You said you hadn't seen against a fighter who can move and gives him good head movement. I would advise that you go on YouTube after the show or in the interim between the fight and check out his first fight with Juan Francisco Estrada that took place in 2012. Estrada did a lot of the things that you were mentioning that you hadn't seen Gonzalez against. Good jab, good move. He had good movement. He went up and down. The toughest fight of Gonzalez's career, so I would advise you to look at that fight because he has seen that fight, that kind of style. Estrada was the only guy who could give him that style, and Gonzalez won in a very good fight, very close fight, but I would advise you to watch that fight in an interim. I'll go to a new one, this one, what you need earlier in the show.
Thanks for the reference. I'm going to definitely check that out.
Okay, no problem. Earlier in the show, what you need, you talked about Canelo Alvarez in terms of how high level of boxer puncher he is and the little subtle things he does that makes him a very effective fighter. When I look at Roman Gonzalez, I think he does a lot of the same things that Canelo does, except he's more consistent. He has a greater punch rate. I personally think his jab is a bit better than Canelo Alvarez. The body punching that each fighter does, they're equivalent. Your breakdown of Chocolatito Gonzalez, of the fights that you've seen him, your assessment of him as a fighter?
Very, very, very good elite fighter. You can see there's a big difference between him and other flyweights and even the super minimum weights and the minimum weights. He's very clean, he's very sharp with his punches, with his hooks, with his jabs, with his combinations. You can see he's looking for openings when he does it. And he's also, what I like about him is he's defensively responsible. So even if he's throwing a shot, he's also looking at how he can block that shot, how he can, the way how he positions his body in space. Canelo is a much bigger guy. You know, Gonzalez is a flyweight, okay?
I'm just talking in terms of this particular style, the way they each guy fights.
Right. Gonzalez is a flyweight, so he's a, you know, he's a small guy, but he's a big small guy, you know? He's a huge flyweight. What he reminds me of is the Filipino boxer Donny Nietes. So those of you guys who know Donny Nietes, go check him out. Love Donny Nietes' style as well. Clean, very sharp, very elite boxer, right? Can box forward or backwards. I haven't really seen too much of Roman having to go on the back foot and move backwards. Usually he pivots, he turns, so the boxer don't really push him back, okay? But I really like Roman Gonzalez's style. When he fought Juan Francisco Estrada, good fight. It was a great fight. I hope that he will face Juan Francisco Estrada again at this higher weight class, a flyweight. I would love to see that matchup again, sort of like a Marquez Pacquiao, except much higher skill involved. And there's a reason he's undefeated for 42 fights. This guy is an elite, elite fighter. I think he is one of his mentors is the great junior middleweight, the guy who fought. He's also from the same place. For reasons beyond me, I cannot Arguello. Remember. Sorry?
Arguello.
Yeah, Alexis Arguello.
Yes, Alexis Arguello.
Yeah. The late Arguello, yeah.
Yes. So he has the kind of pedigree that you can't pay for. You know, he's very, very, this boy is just, he's very sharp, you know. So, yeah, I think his best bet is to fight Juan Francisco Estrada again. Because Juan Francisco Estrada, if I'm not mistaken, he's the super champion at that division right now. He has two belts, I think it is.
Yeah, he has two belts. Yeah, he took one off of Brian Valora, and he's got two belts.
Yeah, Estrada has the WBA WBO belt. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So it would be wonderful to have that unification. I'm glad that HBO has him being featured to the world. It's about time. Maybe 2 to 3 fights down the road, Estrada versus Roman Gonzalez. That would be a big fight. Big.
Yeah. I'm still holding out a possibility for a fight against the Nui, but that's just me. That's just me and Sean. Nui, Sean and I, we both want that fight, yeah.
Isn't the Nui a super flyweight, though?
Yeah, he is.
Yeah, but earlier in the year, Estrada expressed a desire to win a fourth world title in a fourth division. And the rumors early in 2015 that there was going to be a possible showdown between Inoue and Estrada at one of the big end of the year cards
Estrada
in Japan.
Estrada or Gonzalez?
Estrada and Inoue and Gonzalez.
Okay. Yeah, New Year's. They were gonna do a New Year's extravaganza like they did last.
And to Sean's point, I don't know what that deal with HBO will it interfere with the Tekken deal. So that may not happen. But you mentioned Nietes. I was reading a report a month or so ago that should Nietes win his upcoming bout, which is a mandatory, they may try to put him in the ring with Gonzalez. That's
wonderful.
Just rumor, so I don't know.
That would be fantastic. I would love to see that fight.
They're not in the same weight class.
No, they're not.
But the rumor, I gotta find it. It's online. That if Nietes would win, he would move up to fight Gonzalez. Up to flyweight.
That's more like it. I'll tell you what. They all need to stay away from Annette, not Rongrang. He's the one. That guy is trouble. Like, he's got some really good boxing skills. But I think the more them guys there, they're probably beating. But he give you trouble. But he shoots some good.
And actually, EJ, Rung Roy is fighting next month, so.
Yeah, he's fighting in Thailand, but he'd probably win that fight. But what we're saying is that all the names we've mentioned, Fight Fan, you listen, you go check them out. Like, and the guy from, like, what you need just mentioned, the guy from the Philippines, and Yunetis, and obviously we're talking about Annette Rongren from Thailand. These guys are the top caliber.
I love Rongren.
Yeah, he schooled, his name?
Zhu Shimin.
Yeah, I knew that already. I should have put money on that one. I knew he was gonna squeeze. Schooled him to bits, man.
He's not super sharp though.
Yeah, but he's very crafty. And you know, if you don't bring your game, he can beat you. But there's another guy as well. Most other guys. There's loads of Japanese, super good Japanese fighters around that class as well. I know we're talking about Inoue, but there's loads of guys. But it's some good times for HBO. There's some really good fights. Yeah. They're gonna put out. There's some good times.
Yeah, let's get Gail in here to end the show. Gonzalo, we talked about how Triple G, he's getting a lot of coverage in the West Coast and whatnot. So is Gonzalez, as he's getting a lot of attention. Media workout for him this week as well. So talk about the buzz surrounding Chocolatito Gonzalez, who's fought out there before a few times when he fought Estrada. The Anaheim crowd gave him a rousing ovation, him and Estrada. They wanted to see him again badly, and they get to see him again. So,
yeah, he is getting a lot of attention. He's an interesting guy. He's very, very shy in person, and that is sort of amplified by his size. I mean, this is a guy who's literally my size, although he's a tiny, tiny bit taller.
He's a teacup human.
Yeah, he's a small dude, and see him next to Triple G, you know, as they're taking photos at the news conference and so forth, you know, the whole card and everything. There's a female flyweight on the undercard. Siniesa Estrada from East LA is going to fight. She towered over him. It was kind of funny. So there's the novelty aspect to it for a few people. There's also a significant Nicaraguan expatriate community in L.A., and they are really, really excited about seeing him. And, of course, he's facing Sosa, so you've got that element. The Mexican fans will be out in force because they love Triple G, but they're going to love what they see out of Chocolatito. And I predict by the end of that fight, the Mexican fans will completely adopt him as their own. And when that happens, especially in this part of the country, you have a really solid fan base behind you. That's going to be nothing but good for him. And I think he's going to put on quite a show. And, you know, HBO has set this up as kind of a showcase card all the way down. They want all their guys to really perform well for the fans, and they will.
Sean, I'll go to you right quick. You mentioned in the chat room potential fights, opponents for Gonzalez down the road. Speak on that, Sean.
Well, I mean, like you guys were saying already, you know, I mean, there's lots of good fighters within those divisions, and Gonzalez has expressed that he wants to move up to win a fourth title, becoming the first Nicaraguan to do it, you know. So that's why we were very hyped about him with the Inouye fight. But even at that weight for Inouye and other fighters, I mean, Kudris, you know, the great African fighter Tete that had a spectacular knockout victory earlier in the year, you know, great fight. If nobody saw that fight, they should totally watch it. Clinical. And, I mean, it was a great stoppage. And then, I mean, like what you need was saying, you know, Nietes, the Filipino fighter, who is a very good, skilled fighter as well, who has basically dominated the lower divisions. It's a shame that him and Gonzalez didn't fight earlier, before Gonzalez moved up, when he was a champion down at that weight. And then, you know, I mean, everybody has still wanted the Estrada rematch because it was the most competitive fight either one of them were in. A lot of people feel that Estrada won. A lot of people feel that Roman Gonzalez won. So, I mean, whenever that fight, it is a super fight, and it deserves to be treated like a super fight. So I'm sure that's why they're sort of trying to build their names in the States before they sort of push that out there, because the lower weight guys, it's hard to sort of get them to headline a card of that magnitude. But both of those guys, they should be headlining for a fight like that, because that is a spectacular fight.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're going to end the show on that note, because the show has gone really, really long tonight. I want to give an opportunity for the panel to let the folks know where they can find if they want to talk boxing or anything else. Ladies first, I'm going to go with Gail Falcantholo, Communities Digital News. If folks want to hit you up on social media and talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
You bet. I write a column called Ringside Seat for Communities Digital News out of Washington, D.C., and that is diginews.com, and you find them on all the social media channels under that as well. During fights, I am always chatting or maybe listening to our host bitch about referees or bit about something. And my Twitter handle is PRProSanDiego. So you see me there tomorrow night, Friday night fights. We're always chatting. You know, if the fights get boring, the conversation's always entertaining. So I invite you to join me. And I have just posted my preview of the Golovkin bout, including some exclusive video I shot up at the summit. So I encourage you to take a look tonight.
All right, I'll go to Jay Dill. If folks want to talk box or anything else, I'll let the folks know where they can hit you up.
Okay. Now, on the YouTube, there's multiple channels you can reach me by. Out of Control Troll 2, or my main one, J-Dill, J-D-I-L-L, or you can find me on Facebook as John Aristotle, or you could join my boxing group called Face Tweet Boxing, which you combine Facebook and Twitter for the boxing social media, or you can find me on Twitter at Life7 and Joe, J-O, and... Or you can find me on here, or you can find me on EJ Boxing Live, or you can find me on 78 Sports TV on the Lions Den.
I'll go to you. What you need? If folks want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
Well, I'm on Facebook. I'm What You Need. What? WATTUNEED. What You Need.
Sean had to step out because of teaching duties and whatnot. So did Mr. Boxing Addict. He had to step out as well. To find Mr. Boxing Addict, just go to Mr. Boxing Addict, all one word, MrBoxingAddict, on G Plus and Facebook, and also that's his Twitter handle, all one word, Mr. Boxing Addict. Sean Newton, he's all over G Plus, he's all over YouTube, commenting on shows and whatnot. Just go to Sean Newton, S-H-A-W-N, Newton, N-E-W-T-O-N. He'll be everywhere giving comments on various pages, talking boxing and whatnot. EJ Boxing Live, my Boxing UK brother, folks want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
Yeah, EJ Boxing Live on YouTube, Twitter, EJ Boxing Live, yeah, so you can catch me up on that.
And you can check out What You Need as well as myself. We're occasionally on EJ Boxing Live show. He does a show every Sunday, recap advice as well, so you check him out there. Very good show with Mr. Natty Turner, Bill Newmar, Boxing Beats and Rhymes, and others. So check him out every weekend. He's been doing shows for the past few months. I think he's gonna do shows throughout the rest of the year, right?
Yeah, definitely, because he's picked up, man, some good fights so far. So yeah, as long as the good fights keep going, the hangouts will be there, man.
So be sure to check him out there. If you want to follow me, at BrotherJR76 on Twitter. If you want to find anything else about the Pound for Pound Boxing Report, again, go to the blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. Repeat that, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. And if you look on the right of the page, you can find links to where to find us all over social media, all over the interwebs. Podomatic, where you can find all the podcasts, Facebook, Tumblr, G+, the two G+ pages, Twitter, YouTube, got a Pinterest board, RSS feed. You're also on Stitcher Radio, the email address, as well as a link to donate your account. I'm going to take next week off. I'm going to return in 2 weeks to talk about Triple G and Monroe, Gonzalez, Edgar Sosa. We also talk about the fights that's going to be happening the week off, as well as we're going to do a preview of Americana. He's going to be fighting Chris Algieri. Also, we want to talk about Kell Brook fighting Frankie Gavin. I know it's a bum fight, but hell, we got to talk about it anyway. But the undercard is what I'm excited about. Jorge Linares fighting Kevin Mitchell, which should be a very good fight. Evgeny Gradovich fighting Lee Selby. And I'm saying it right now, I think Lee Selby will beat Gradovich and become the featherweight champion of the world. Also, Anthony Joshua, who we mentioned earlier in the show, he's going to be fighting Kevin Johnson on that card. So we're going to be talking about those fights. We're going to be, again, going to take next week off. We will see you in 2 weeks. So for Gail Falkenthal, for EJ Boxing Live, for What You Need, for Sean Newton, for Mr. Boxing Addict, for Jay Dill, I am Michael, and this has been another episode of the Pound for Pound Box Report. Y'all have a good evening. Good night.
Night. All right.